Thanks for being with us today to join us in a conversation about the city. The city of Spokane is joining communities across the country, including Seattle and Tacoma, in petitioning the U.S. Supreme Court to review two cases that have significantly shaped how cities address homelessness up and down the West Coast. I am joined by Councilmember Jonathan Bingle. He has been very, very involved in our conversations about a regional homeless authority. Phil Altmaier from the Union Gospel Mission, as you know, very closely has been following this, operates a shelter and with great outcomes and success, and also transitional housing programs. And then Captain Kane from the Salvation Army, relatively new to Spokane. He operates our Trent Resource and Assistance Center, the Way Out Transitional Housing Program, and other supportive programs for families and individuals. As you all know, homelessness is a very complex challenge. It requires a multitude of resources and approaches. One of those is emergency night-by-night shelters. The city of Spokane has invested very heavily in increasing capacity and service connection in our services. It has been successful. It's also very, very expensive. Transitional housing investments in programs have been also very successful. I will say, however, local law that's based on case law requires us to prioritize getting people indoors and connected to those services, and that oftentimes means that we reduce other resources available to get people through the system, and it does have barriers as opposed to the low barrier night-by-night emergency shelters. And then also permanent housing. We have been building capacity, and we've gotten great success when units become available. This does require the greatest investment, and it also has some barriers. So we are petitioning the U.S. Supreme Court because we believe that we have to remove limitations on our ability to address the homeless crisis as cities. Spokane has now joined the petition asking the U.S. Supreme Court to review Martin versus Boise and Johnson versus Grants Pass. More than a dozen cities and counties and also national associations have joined us in this effort. There is a reasonable request that we're making of this. It's critically important to our future. Homelessness has spiked nationwide in the last 15 years. In just the state of Washington, it's gone up nearly 41%. Washington now has the fourth largest percentage of homeless population behind California, New York, and Florida, and a third of the nation's homeless now reside in the Ninth Circuit. So we believe that something needs to be done. Local jurisdictions need to have more control about how we address homelessness. And we are right now having to spend more of our resources than we really want on those night-by-night emergency low-barrier shelters. We need to be able to invest in other resources that we know move people out of homelessness. So I'm going to ask Councilmember Bingle now to talk about why it's important that we join this effort, along with Phil and then Captain Kane, and then we'll take questions after that.
All right. Thank you, Mayor. I appreciate your leadership and your staff's leadership on this issue. One of the things that we know is that we have a significant population of homeless individuals in the city of Spokane, and we want to be able to provide as much housing and help as possible. One of the difficulties that we run into is that to provide the services that are essentially mandated on the city of Spokane requires a lot of resources that we don't always have. For me, the reason why this is important is because it does help cities like Spokane and Seattle and Tacoma shape their homeless response based on their communities. And restoring that local control, I think, is really important. Because we do have different challenges than Seattle and Tacoma and Boise. We have unique Spokane challenges, and for us to best address this issue in our community, we need to be able to have control. And so I'm excited that we're joining this. I think it's going to be a great thing for the city of Spokane, and as somebody who's very involved in our regional homeless authority discussions, we are trying to find pathways to help as many people as possible, and I think this is just going to continue to give us the flexibility that we need to address the issue in the way that we as a community want to address it. So Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Council Bingle and Phil Olmeyer.
So I've been in Spokane 37 years working with homelessness, and this issue is really important to me because, like many of you, you have seen the change in what's happened in our city with people on the sidewalks, under bridges, everywhere sleeping. That all came about because of the decision by the Ninth Circuit District Court. And I want to start by just saying, if we have compassion for the homeless people in our city, the most important thing they can have is a bed, a table to sit down and eat at, and the services that begin to move them in a positive direction. And so I really am excited that this will be the second time this goes before the Supreme Court, and they're going to make a decision in October. I hope with all the cities and more, they had, I believe, 31 attorneys. I don't think this is a Republican-Democrat issue. For the first time, Governor Newsom has said, hey, it's time to address this problem and what it's caused across the country and our cities. So I'm hoping we'll look at this from the standpoint of compassion for the homeless and what we do to get them off the street. I know this, if we're going to move people through programs where it starts with shelter to recovery, which is our main focus, and we see homeless people every day. 300 and some people got jobs last year that went through our shelters. We're taking people through long-term addiction recovery. We're seeing families restored, lives changed. But I know it starts when you walk into a shelter. That's the beginning of the process. You don't go from the street feeding the needle every day to recovery. It starts when you start getting into sober and clean environments with encouragement where hope is offered. So to me, as a country, to recognize what we've done hasn't worked and to change that and move people in that direction, I'm excited. And I'm glad our city has said, we want to speak out loud to the Supreme Court, get their attention and say, do something this time around. So I'm hoping they take up the case and action is taken. Thank you.
Phil, can you just, we were just talking about just the addiction crisis that we have on our street because of the decriminalization of drugs in the last 2 years, and you had made a comment about people don't understand addiction.
Yeah.
Can you?
Yeah, I think this whole thing, what we have allowed year in and year out for addicts to stay on the streets feeding their addiction, we don't understand the power and strength of addiction. If you haven't understood what it does to the brain and the mind and the thinking, I don't know about you, it's starting to get cold. Can you imagine someone choosing to sleep on the sidewalks tonight? Well, that ought to tell you something about addiction. People don't think clearly. They don't make smart decisions. And so if we continue to allow it, I want to tell you, it not only impacts the person, it impacts the city that we live in. And I want to tell you, our city is on the most beautiful river. When guests come here, they always comment how beautiful our downtown is. But I'm telling you, when you have people and drugs and garbage and everything else, that beauty goes away and so do the businesses. And if you're following what's happening, that's happening in major cities all up and down the West Coast. That's why I believe Newsom is finally saying enough is enough. But again, to understand what we're dealing with is to understand addiction and how a person thinks. And what does it mean to love and help them? To let them stay in that condition or to say there's something better for you? And so I believe that's what this will do, the beginning of change, and it's how we have compassion for people.
Thank you, Phil. And then Captain Kane,
Salvation
Army's been our community for more than 100 years, operating very, very successful programs, a multitude of different programs. So.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here. I want to make sure that I preface the fact that we're here to speak from our organizational approach to addressing homelessness and the priority that we find in making sure that not only do we work well with our government partners, but that we also stay true to our ethic that treats all people as invaluable and irreplaceable in God's eyes. And that ethic also drives us to find creative models that are beyond just crisis aversion for those we serve. We find that our greatest sources of success in addressing homelessness means that we look at a person as we see more for them than they could even see for themselves. And we understand that when a person is in a place of crisis, that they can't see past their emergency. And so an emergency bed is essential to the progress of the person, but there's so much more. And so we've intentionally created programs such as our Way Out shelter, which has a 50% success rate for those that go through our program. We know that when people are surrounded by a healthy community, when they're no longer worried about what they will eat or in that crisis, when their next fix will come, that as they begin to surround themselves with healthy people who have a vision for them, that we see long-term change happening. And so the Salvation Army is invested in our community because we love and want to serve the people that are struggling in the worst situations. And we're grateful for a community that wants to circle around us in that effort. We see that as the greatest level of compassion, not just to put a Band-Aid on a need, but to make intentional steps towards the progression of all people.
All right, thank you, Captain Kane. I should just let you know, too, that the Ninth Circuit did provide some clarity to the cases that we're talking about, making a distinction between voluntary and involuntary homeless. So if we have a shelter bed, if we are moving someone off of a sidewalk or a public space or along the river, and we offer them a bed, they are no longer involuntarily homeless. They are choosing not to seek shelter, they are choosing not to seek services, and they are now considered voluntarily homeless. And that's a distinction that was just made this week. It may have purposely been done to preclude this particular effort, but just wanted to update you on that as well. So, does anyone have any questions?
Mayor, just a technical question. What exactly is the city doing? Are we just filing an amicus brief?
We're part of it's an amicus brief, yes. Yeah. And it's quite an effort. You guys all have a news release, but for those who, if you're streaming or if anybody's watching that way, the number of cities, we're talking to Albuquerque, Anchorage, Colorado Springs, Henderson, Las Vegas, Milwaukee, Providence, Redondo Beach, St. Paul, San Diego, Seattle, Tacoma, Honolulu, San Bernardino County. It's a huge effort.
Mayor, if this amicus brief, if this court rules in these communities' favor, how does that specifically change your administration's, the city's approach to homelessness? What are the specific changes that you foresee this granting our homelessness response?
Well, we are challenged with funding what we're operating right now. The Trent Resource and Assistance Center is seeing more than 300 people every single night. So we have 300 people who are off the streets, who are connected to services. Mm. We have a service provider there, Revive. We're going to be offering virtual court there very, very soon so that people can resolve any criminal justice history that is precluding them from seeking services or providing a barrier for them. That it's seen great success, but it's also very, very expensive. Right now, if we were required to have a shelter bed for every single homeless person, we would have to duplicate that shelter numerous times, and we just don't have the funding to do that. So this would give us the opportunity to spend monies on transitional programs and other options that really are probably more successful than just your night-by-night emergency shelter low barriers. We can strategically invest in programs that are seeing much better outcomes.
But that would the focus completely change on the night-by-night? Would it still be?
Oh yeah, that's part of the full system. But it wouldn't be, we're spending more of our resources right now on that. And that's the challenge. That's the struggle that cities are having.
Mr. Altmaier, could you answer a question, please?
Sure.
You mentioned that you feel like the most important first step for the homeless is a bed and a meal. The practical effect of removing Martin v. Boise is that the city would not be required to provide shelter in order to enforce homeless laws.
Yeah.
How is this not, in your mind, a move backwards?
I see it as a move forward because I didn't address the other issue we're dealing with our streets, sit and lie, camping. It's lawlessness. It cleans up a city. So the number of people I believe that we see that are homeless, it's going to change the choices they have to make. And so from that standpoint, I see this being positive. Either people are going to move in the direction to get the help they need, but they won't be allowed to continue in their addiction, sit and lie, laying on our streets, using drugs day in and day out. We have not been able to address that issue. Well, let me correct that, because I want this for the record. Cities have corrected that problem that have had a city council that'll stand up and have guidelines and not allow sit and lie, like San Antonio, Texas. You don't see that in their city. Unfortunately, I think our city battles with this question. Well, we have Boise Martin. Can we really enforce it? That will be gone. We can enforce it. So I hope that answers your question.
Mayor, can you elaborate on that? Do you believe that this change would change the number of people who are homeless, or would this, critics will say that this would simply push them further out in a field, that they would just not be as visible. Do you actually think that this would change the problem fundamentally?
Well, I think what it would do is it would help jurisdictions be able to compel people to get services. Because right now, I just don't think there are enough tough boundaries or guardrails to get them into services. And what Phil just described, that we see in parks and on the streets, in public spaces, are people who are addicted, who don't want to go to shelters. And what I hear from neighbors, people in the community, mothers who can't take their children to the park because of all the needles and the drug activity, people who complain about not being able to use public spaces because they're not safe, this balances out this challenge that we have of getting people connected to resources. How do we address people who don't want those resources? And how do we keep our cities and communities safe? We have a right to have a safe city. And because of the lawlessness that has resulted in some of these decisions, it's very, very challenging to keep our public spaces safe and to keep communities safe for everybody.
Can I add this? And I think this is important. We don't receive government funds, okay? But what I see happening with people because of the lawlessness that's associated with homelessness and what we see in our city, people are losing their compassion to help. And the people that walk through our doors are coming to a safe, clean, sober. They want help. They want life change. And that's why we see the results through our recovery programs and what we see happen. So my concern is a bigger picture, that a lot of times we put everyone that's lawless in this same bucket and we see them all the same. There are legitimate reasons people are homeless. But again, my concern is people lose the compassion because of the damage, the cost of homelessness, and what we're seeing with our city literally being destroyed in some ways. So to me, I have a real energy about this, because I see it hurting the homeless themselves, what we've allowed. Because that's not a picture of everyone that's homeless, what we see on the street. So I just wanted to share that and why I'm so passionate about this as well. It's affecting those that maybe their story's different and they want something different.
Anybody else? Do we currently have sufficient police resources to enforce this? Mm-hmm.
Oh, well, we never have enough police resources, and we're always working on that as well. But we have seen a huge impact on the emphasis at Second and Division in the last couple of weeks. That has been a challenging spot for many, many years. The concentration of formerly chronically homeless and those who are chronically homeless on the streets has had an incredible impact on our main gateway into our city, to the businesses that operate there, to the people who frequent those businesses, employers who employ people there. We need to be able to, I wish we had more resources to be able to enforce. But this is going to be a good next first step so that we have more guardrails to get people help.
What's the alternative here if you just said that some of these people don't want help, they don't want to go to shelters, they don't want resources, but if these are enforced, what's the alternative there for those people who just flat out don't want services?
Well, they can't just live on the street anymore. They can't just occupy public spaces and create dangerous environments for our families and the people who live in our city.
Currently, there's, of course, Proposition 1 that would expand, even within the scope of Martin v. Boise, what can be enforced regardless of shelter beds. But that would not affect current penalties, which are cite and release, not, the city law dictates that you're not supposed to get booked into jail for violating these laws. Do you think that should be changed? Is cite and release sufficient? Even if Martin v. Boise is overturned, that would still be the...
I think it's still a tool. We have to have all the tools that we can possibly have to keep our community safe. I think we will continue to exercise the tools that we have. But this will certainly be a game changer for local jurisdictions. And I think it's really important that we are part of this effort.
Would you advocate for stronger penalties?
We'll look at that. We'll actually look at that. Right now, we don't have capacity, even for some of the things that we can enforce, especially at the city level, when it comes to misdemeanors. So there is no capacity right now in the jail for misdemeanors. It's just for felons. And we're having conversations about how we create more capacity, because we do have to have consequences for people who are breaking the law. And they know right now that we don't have capacity, even if they're arrested, charged, and booked. So there has to be consequences. I've said this before, and I'll say it again, we have to make crime illegal again.
So, question for Councilman Bingle. If this challenge is approved, Martin v. Boise, the scope of it is kind of diminished. From your perspective, all the conversations you've been having with the Regional Homeless Authority, how would that impact things from that perspective? Are those conversations ongoing right now on saying, hey, this is a possibility, we're joining in on this, this might impact this, so on and so forth?
I think that what this will allow us to do as we're building the Regional Homeless Authority is it'll help us to be more effective, because what we're wanting to do is help people who are interested in taking that step forward in moving on from homelessness. There's a variety of reasons why people are homeless, and there's no shortage of compassion for individuals in this city if you are looking to get out of that, if you are looking to exit that space. It will also help us as... Phil was talking earlier, it will help us help the people who really want the help much better. And if you are interested in having the taxpayers fund, an addiction lifestyle where everything is taken care of for you, I think it's time for us as a city to make a strong statement that that's unacceptable in the city of Spokane. If you're looking for help and you're wanting to exit, we will absolutely help you. We will get you all the services and all the help that you need. So I think this helps us be more effective helping those who are looking to exit. So.
Any concerns that the Supreme Court could turn the other direction and make this law of the land for the entire country?
I don't. We're just very happy to be able to, I think, put forward even a better case for our cities before the U.S. Supreme Court, because this was passed in 2018, and we've been living with this for quite a while. It hasn't worked. I mean, just look at the statistics. It just hasn't worked. We've got to do something different. You know, we always say the definition of insanity is doing the same thing, expecting different results. We're spending more, and the issue is getting worse. The challenge is getting worse.
Is there a backup plan in place in case the Supreme Court doesn't overturn these decisions? Can the city find funding somewhere for more shelter beds?
Well, that's one of the biggest challenges, is that the funding that we do have to address homelessness is not sustainable. Mm-hmm. There are state and federal grants. We're always advocating at the state level to help us fund this challenge. They have stepped up, lawmakers, to some degree with the right-of-way initiative funding that is used to move people out of encampments into housing. We didn't see much success with that at Camp Hope, $25 million. Spent and very, very few people permanently housed. So we need a better approach. All right. Thank you, everybody. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Mary.